May I take a moment to welcome you all for this talk on equality, multicultural in education, which is co-organized by the School of Health and Social Science and Equality and Diversity Unit of the University of Edinburgh. And before we get started, I would like to introduce our speaker for today to you. It's both my pleasure and honor to introduce him to you all. He is Dr. Damien comes from a teaching and social work background. He has researched different aspects of life course transitions of young people, including minor asylum seekers and young people in care. Not to mention his good publication records of journals, book chapters, book reviews, and many presentations around in the UK. He obtained his PhD in sociology from the University of Malta in 2007. Dr. Damien also has been teaching in many academic institutions, and I'm proud to say that one of the institutions is in Scotland. So today, Dr. Damien will give an overview of how cultural and cross-cultural competence can be both understood and expressed differently, and will show how college and universities can generate an overall culture wherein people will act in a way that both acknowledge and respect ethnic, social, cultural, and linguistic diversity. So he will use insight from his recently published book, Multiculturalism, Higher Education, and Intercultural Communication. So now, without delaying, I proudly invite Dr. Damien to deliver his presentation. Thank you.
I thank you for that very warm introduction, and I thank you all for being here and for joining me in this mutual exploration of what multicultural education is all about. And I have purposely produced this question: how can cultural and cross-cultural competence be co-created at university, where the emphasis is on co-created? Very, very often, going back to my own student days and going through my days as a lecturer, it so happens that sometimes students say, but why don't lecturers do this? Why doesn't the university do this? Why doesn't so-and-so do this? And my answer to these questions is usually, well, why don't you, as students, do something about it? And more than that, why don't you, as students, do something together with the lecturers? Hence the notion of co-creation. Co-creation is about power. It is about a sharing of power. And essentially, the way I see multicultural education is an avenue to enable people, to allow people, and to empower people to share power. In the narrative literature, in the literature on narrative psychology, much emphasis is laid on the notion of positioning. Who am I in relation to you? Very, very often, positioning is associated with roles. And with roles comes power and comes authority. Within a multicultural education setting, the ideal would be that those roles would not be rigid. You will not have the lecturer and the student, but there will be a co-facilitation. At certain points, it will be the students who, in a way, are leading the discussion. Outside the lecture rooms, however, in the informal spaces, in universities and in colleges, the same also applies. Sometimes we form clubs and we form settings where people take on the role of secretary or leader, which is all good and fine. But they must not be allowed to define the person. They must not be allowed to define the relationship, if there is to be co-creation. Because co-creation, the emphasis is on the co-working, on the cooperation, on the co-enabling of things and of events and of circumstances that will arise between people. I love this picture. I have the whole world in my hands. It is a small child and the innocence of a child. And I do not know whether, perhaps, if we remember, if we go back to our childhood days, maybe we had a small adventure where we climbed on a wall and one of our parents very lovingly told us, be very careful you don't fall off, because if you fall off, you'll hurt yourself. You're going to fall off, you're going to fall off. And our adventure would have been spoilt. And in reality, it is this innocence of children that can make co-creation possible. It is this belief that I can achieve. It is this belief that I can make a difference in other people's lives. It is a belief that, yes, I am able to reach out to the other person. It is a belief that I can question any negative messages, that I can fall off the wall, and I can believe that I can stay on the wall. So ultimately, if we are talking about beliefs, we are also talking about something else. We are also talking about our own personal branding. Much emphasis is made on the literature, and much emphasis is also made in the marketing sphere about brands. Some brands are superior to others. I must look this way, and I must look that way. There is not necessarily any harm in this, but it is what I do with that that can be harmful. Therefore, if I believe that my branding is such that I am superior to the other, if I believe that I know it all, if I believe that I have nothing to learn from the other, then my branding is going to have a negative impact on the way I relate to other people. Bennett, in his writings about society, refers to what I am calling as branding. He refers to it as ethnocentrism, where I make myself the center of the world. But this is not what I have intended in this slide. When I say I have the whole world in my hands, as a child, it means I can relate to the other person. I believe in myself. I believe in my capacity to relate. I believe in my capacity to understand. This slide is actually based on a root experience which I had as a teacher some years back. I was teaching at a school on the island of Malta, which is a European island not far from Italy, and where the majority of the people are whites. From the year 2000-2001 onwards, Malta started receiving quite a number of boatloads of asylum seekers from Africa. And logically, the Africans are blacks. When I was in this school, and I was speaking to the Maltese boys with a view to introducing the Africans, with a view to getting them to co-create a mutual space where they could generate some form of understanding and ideally build on that understanding to foster friendships, I found that contrary to perhaps the anti-racist literature from countries like the United States and other countries where black communities were well established, but unfortunately there was this racist tendency, blacks against blacks sometimes, whites against whites sometimes, it's not always as clear-cut as sometimes one is inclined perhaps to believe. But in any case, it was certainly not the case with the Maltese boys. They did not believe in any way in white superiority. It was rather a fear of the unknown. They feared the blacks because they were Africans. They were from a different land. They did not speak the same language. They would not understand them. The whole notion was the notion of fear. And fear is the one fundamental enemy of human relationships. I cannot relate to you meaningfully if I am scared of you. If any of us in this room have been through the unfortunate experience of being bullied, or perhaps they know somebody who has been bullied. They will know how hard it is for the victim to speak up, speak out, and say, "Listen, I am feeling hurt. Please don't offend me anymore." And it is this fear which I believe we need to uproot if in universities we are to co-create a space where people feel safe enough to be themselves and to thereby say, "Yes, I have the whole world in my hands." I would like to produce a model of cultural competence which is based on different tenets of different authors. So I've brought a number of different perspectives together. And the first one is cultural self-awareness. If any of us come from a teaching background or from a social work background or perhaps from a nursing background, they will notice that much of their course is directed at being self-reflective. Therefore, the lecturer would actually ask questions and say, "But why have you said this? Why have you said that you have felt this?" The idea isn't to make you feel in a certain way, but the idea is to get you to engage in reflective questioning. And it is the same with cultures. Why do I feel at home with people from a certain culture and not at home with people from another culture? The same can be said also about class backgrounds. The same can also be said with people whom we see as different in some way or another. The notion of self-awareness is in itself a very, very, very powerful tool. Why do I think this? Why do I feel this? Why do I believe this? And unless one is reflective, it is very, very, very difficult for one to have cultural knowledge on a feelings level. It is technically possible for one to read a book, go for an exam, do the exam, pass the exam, gold star, and that on that level, that will be done. But on the feelings level, there will be nothing there. And the unfortunate thing is that if there is nothing on the feelings level, most probably, once that exam is over, the student would have forgotten whatever there was that was written on that paper 1 month down the line. What brings memory? What is the force which will bring memory into our lives, into whichever examination or into whichever experience we have? The memory expert Bruno First, says that there needs to be three things. There needs to be color, there needs to be exaggeration, and there needs to be feeling. And my emphasis is on feeling. Cultural knowledge is rooted in relationships. Relationships are related in feelings. The social worker Felix Bischteck, in a 1957 book, rather dated, but nevertheless, I think quite an innovative and novel text, speaks about relationships like a wriggly worm, where just as the worm wriggles, hence our feelings, our intensity, our reality will change and will build up. Come cultural knowledge, will come cultural sensitivity. And cultural sensitivity is associated with empathy. Therefore, if I were to take the Maltese students, and the Maltese students are fearing the Africans because they are from Africa, because they are black, because they are from a different background, and they are white, and they are from Malta. Cultural sensitivity is going out of that reality. What does it mean to leave one's land where there is war, where there is famine? What does it mean to feel the despair, to get onto a boat and to travel on a wooden boat or some form of a dinghy from Africa to Malta? What does it mean to arrive in a strange land where one barely speaks the language? What disappointments do the asylum seekers face if their intention was in fact to reach Italy and therefore mainland Europe and instead finished up on a very, very small island like Malta? What are the meanings? What are the implications? And ultimately, and perhaps more cogently, if now that these people are in Malta, if, let us say, some Africans eat with their hands, whereas in Malta, as a European nation, people would eat with their forks and knives, what does that mean? What does that say to me? What does my reactions say about me? So cultural competence is to do with this ability to empathize, this ability to feel, this ability to understand, this ability to convey understanding, hence mutual understanding, hence the notion of co-creating. Now, some people might say, but Damien, surely co-creating understanding in an intercultural communication, the example that you have taken about the Africans and the Maltese and the Africans coming from an asylum-seeking background and the Maltese having been, well, it's their land since time immemorial, so to speak, is somewhat of an extreme example. And that criticism would be a correct criticism. But in some way, we will always find these differences. And it is good and it is healthy that there are these differences, because if there were not to be these differences, there would not be any plurality of cultures, and we would all be the same. We would all be English, if English can be seen as a culture. We would all be Italian, if Italian can be seen as a culture. Although once again, one can obviously contest this and say, what does being an Italian mean? What does being an English mean? And is it true that there is such a thing as a homogeneous English culture, Italian culture, and so on and so forth? But the issue is that if one were to go in depth and one were to explore these differences, one would find that very, very often there are those differences with which one feels quite comfortable, and there are those differences with which one feels less comfortable. And it is hence the need for self-awareness. Why am I feeling less comfortable? And what is this saying about me? Is it really an issue of the other person, or is it my own issue? Is there something I cannot accept? And Freudian theory now comes in, sort of those denials and projections and displacements, sort of the things I don't accept. Do I sort of blame the other person? Do I put the other person down? Do I avoid the other person? Do I project my own insecurities on the other person? And all of this comes into play in intercultural communication. And hence that slide, I have the whole world in my hands. If it has to be, it starts with me. Much of the literature speaks about cultural competence. Some refer to it as cultural intelligence, and some refer to it as almost a subset of emotional intelligence. And I would say that these words are practically interchangeable. To have emotional intelligence, one does need a degree of cultural intelligence, because as stated, there are so many different cultures within the same culture. There are so many different beliefs that can constitute a culture within the same culture. And cultural competence is about establishing these relationships in a meaningful way. So if one were to go from relationships and focus on mutuality or focus on rapport, ultimately the question is, what is my disposition? What is my attitude? What is my belief? Some people, I'm sure that all of us at some point have gone through this experience, when we approach people and somehow they're either cold or they put us off or they say the wrong thing or they do the wrong thing, and somehow this relationship, it doesn't quite gel together. This is on the level of dispositions. And in a relationship, there's always going to be more than one person involved, at least in an interpersonal relationship. So, dispositions, what I feel, what I think, what I believe, my attitude, the messages I convey, they are all important because they are what ultimately can make this divide between me and the other person whom I perceive as cold break down. I will speak about a personal experience where once I was, as a student, living with two other students. And at first, I could not gel with them for some reason or another. Don't ask me why. And then one fine day, I remember it was Christmas time, and I told them, listen, why don't we sort of go out together for a pizza? You know, have something together. It's Christmas time. And it was amazing. With that little bit of an icebreaker, the whole relationship changed, and we really became good friends. Just something so simple. Now, what had really changed? One might say that it served as an icebreaker. But I think that what changed was my own disposition. I had changed. And an author who writes about this in a somewhat different way, but in a lovely way, is Scott Peck. And in his book, In Search of Community, he speaks about a group of priests, of old priests in a priory. And he says that these old priests were gradually dying off and nobody was joining the priory. And then one of the priests came up with the idea of telling the other priests, well, what if one of us is the Messiah? And they started treating the other with respect. They started not taking the other for granted. They started creating things together. And what was once a dying order, according to Scott Peck, then became very much alive, became very much vibrant. And this is what we need to remember when we find it difficult to relate in intercultural settings. And this is the message we need to convey, that unless we believe, I wouldn't say it's impossible, because I would say never, but I would say, yes, it is extremely difficult to achieve. Now, interactions need to be put in a context. If we were to think, going back since our early days when we were in preschool, of how we made friends, the first thing is we talked to the other person. And this is cardinal. Now, some people might argue, but across cultures, sometimes people won't talk back to you. For instance, let us take, for instance, in certain Arab cultures, if you are a man, it is not allowed, for instance, that you speak to a woman you do not know. Or in other cultures, there are other traditions, other mores. For instance, some people do not shake hands, while others shake hands quite openly. Others embrace, they hug one another. But ultimately, talking is going to be the vehicle that somehow is going to cross that divide. So while one has to remain respectful of cultural norms, of cultural practices, one has also, within one's safe space, within one's possible space, to try to create a context where one can talk and where one can use self-expression. With talking and associating with talking is interaction. But there is a difference between talking and interaction, and particularly in co-creating a multicultural context. Because interaction within a multicultural context is about giving importance to the other, because it is about understanding the other. It is about imagining the world from the other person's perspective. It is, in a way, about joining in the other person's world. So the value is a value of exchange. The value is on personal self-enrichment, besides being the enrichment of the other. Having said this, interaction and talking themselves will then lead to validating. And validating is possibly one of the most important crux of communication. And I can say this because going slightly to the side, going slightly out of context, very often marriages do break down because of a lack of validation. This is something I have found through my experience as a social worker, where the person feels okay to be okay, where the person can feel okay to be himself and to be herself, where the person feels and believes that the person has enough time to be with the other person. So validation as a construct is more integral than intercultural communication, but it also has a role to play here. Unless we can motivate people to be themselves, unless we can encourage people to be themselves, unless we can show them that we do respect their differences, we do listen to them, we do care about them, ultimately, the relationship is not going to get very, very far. And after validating, particularly within university contexts, particularly within the co-construction of relationships, I would say comes supporting. How much are we there to support one another? I remember going back in time as a small boy, one of the teachers of physical education had told myself and my classmates, I think I was about 12 years old, you know, somebody who's not good at football makes a good shot. Tell him he makes a good shot. Support him in making a good shot. So in other words, if a person, because of their own cultural background, might find it difficult to make the first step, and they do make the first step, do support it, do validate it, do encourage it, perhaps the person on his or her own. You know, I really liked what you said today, or I really liked, you know, the wisdom behind what you said, or depending obviously on the context, on the inquiry. And this is why the interactions need to be placed in their own particular context. I've included the awareness wheel because I started off with self-reflexivity and I laid emphasis on self-reflexivity, explaining also that it is part of the core curricula in many of the helping professions. And in reality, awareness can take place on so many, many different levels, possibly more levels than there are in this one diagram. And very, very often, when we are in an interaction with the other, particularly if the other comes from a culture with which we are little familiar, very, very often, many of these things we will not give importance to, or they would not be in our conscious recollection. Rather like if one says the heart is beating, one does not normally think that one's heart is beating. One would have to put one's hand on one heart to notice that one's heart is beating and bring it into conscious awareness. Very, very often, it is this cacophony, so to speak, of data, this different colors, so to speak, if one were to put this in color, different colors of the dynamics of our interactions which come into play. So our assumptions, our beliefs, our expectations, our opinions, what do we want out of the relationship? The emotions that we have spoken about, the aspirations that we have, the intentions in our mind, the sensory data, the data that we give the other person, the data of which we're aware, the data of which we're unaware, they all come into play into these interactions. And if we are to literally co-create and consciously co-create cultural awareness, cultural sensitivity, cultural dialogue, cultural understanding, cultural empathy, in some way we would be touching on ourselves and on the other persons, on many, if not all, of these different levels. The reason why I believe there is emphasis on the past, present, and future is that some relationships can be quite expressive. They can be just relationships for the there and then. But sometimes there are relationships which build up step by step to become deeper or to become more meaningful. In the sense that if we are in a class of students and the students are from different backgrounds, or if we are in a university club or a university setting where there are students from different cultural backgrounds, we know that those people we are going to meet more than once. We might be meeting them throughout the whole course. We ourselves need to question, you know, are we asking something of this friendship? Are we asking something of ourselves in this relationship? What are we expecting out of it? And this particularly becomes the case when young people particularly, but even older people, I suspect, are given projects and they are left on their own. I have found this as a teacher and as a lecturer when sort of I have remained more or less in the background and sort of let the students sort of become more self-directed, and have noticed that very, very often cultural differences do come to the fore when they have a common goal and when they feel that either that goal is being contributed to or else that goal is being detracted from. And that brings in conflict. Conflict, though, is not necessarily bad, is not necessarily harmful. It is the way the conflict is resolved. Hence, the importance of awareness. What do I expect out of this relationship? What am I asking of this person? Can this person give what I am asking? Can this person understand what I am asking? If this person is doing too much, because this can happen as well, why is the person doing too much? Is it perhaps because the person comes from a culture where perfectionism is revered? Should I say something about it or should I not say something about it? And should I say something about it to the person individually or should I say it to the person as a group? Obviously, there are no straight answers to these questions, but they are certainly questions that one needs to keep in mind if one is going to truly create a multicultural culture within a university setting where people are happy and where people feel listened to, validated, and involved. The literature on effective cross-cultural communication is rife with a number of, so to speak, recipes, the things we need to do. I look at them as suggestions, but I would not discard these suggestions because very, very, very often these suggestions are in reality rooted in the experiences of the writer and of the author. But having said that, one obviously needs to first and foremost, see where one is in the relationship, what one is expecting out of the relationship or out of the encounter, and ultimately, whether intervening will help the relationship to gel more. And if not, why not? Life in itself is full of learning experiences, and the most valuable learning experiences, I believe, are the experiences that we have when we relate to other people. But in the recipe book, for want of a better word, suggested for effective cross-cultural communication is developing self-awareness, acknowledging complexity. Sometimes things might be beyond us. And here I'm not afraid to say, yes, there's Mr. Google sometimes. He comes in very, very handy. Let me find out something more about this culture. Let me try and understand what this person's beliefs are. Let me try and understand more the context where this person is coming from. Acknowledge complexity. Avoid labeling or stereotyping or categorizing. In the cognitive therapy literature, there is a lot of emphasis, particularly on depression and black and white thinking, it is called, or generalistic thinking, or over-categorized thinking. And essentially, what this is essentially putting people, so to speak, in the same basket. I once attended a talk, and the way categorizing was explained was saying, you know, certain students in a certain school uniform would be seen as sort of the more prestigious, and other students in another school uniform would be seen sort of as less prestigious because their school carries less prestige. That is an example of categorizing, which, as we all know, is totally unfounded thinking. Because ultimately, you can have students who misbehave in one group, and a certain amount of misbehavior is healthy, and you can have students who misbehave in another group, and obviously, again, a certain degree of a misbehavior is also healthy. So in reality, it's very, very often these constructs which people build. Engage listening. And I believe that the most beautiful example that I had of engaged listening was when I was myself a small boy, and I remember I had gone to Valletta, which is the capital city of Malta, and there were quite a number of people there shoving and pushing around. And I turned to my grandfather and I said, but why are all these pushing around? Why are all these people pushing around? And his engaged listening took the form of putting me on his shoulder so that I would see all these people. This is Malta, not New York, so there would not be that many, but to a small boy, it seemed quite a lot of people. So the engaged listening took the form of putting me on his shoulders so that I would have a better view. And ultimately, sometimes this is what we are called to do in multicultural settings, where we would, not obviously physically, if I had to put somebody on my shoulders, I think I'd fall on the ground immediately, but symbolically, yes, how can I bring this person to see things perhaps from a different perspective? The notion of transparency. Listen, I can't understand you. I once had a lecturer actually in counseling who said, don't be scared to look stupid. Ask questions. If you don't understand, ask questions. It's not a disgrace to ask questions. And fair enough. Sometimes it's a question, okay, why do you like doing things this way? You like things doing that way? Do you eat meat? Do you eat fish? You know, sometimes it's a question of being transparent, asking the questions and saying, okay, I like to do things this way myself, but let's see if there's a way that we can work things out, to be adaptable. So in other words, if some people eat with their hands and you eat with a knife and fork, somehow you have to try and prepare dishes at least where you might be able to find the common ground where you would feel comfortable and they would feel comfortable if you don't feel comfortable eating with your hands in the way that they do. Some people eat with chopsticks, some people eat with forks and knives. It might be possible to have both on the table, why ever not? So the question of being adaptable, of being there, of putting the other person and making the other person central. Asking for clarification, and this comes with feedback. Feedback is a source of growth. If people do not like things, and they tell you do not like things, it's not a question that we get offended. They are from a different culture. They are, in a way, from a different world, perhaps, to ours. They might have a different upbringing to ourselves. Hence, the notion of perspectives. And this also links again to having the whole world in my hands. Because if I have the whole world in my hands, that means that I am open. I am open to understanding. I am open to being receptive to others and to other people's views. The meanings within culture, I love this slide. Simply one sign, and it can mean so many different things. It can mean so many different things. Although I am not from Russia, and if somebody does that, I would think it would mean zero. But having said that, it seems to be the case. Okay. Sometimes, in the literature, one comes across different ways of categorizing different cultures, which is good and fine, so long as we don't take it, for want of a better way of putting it, as the Bible. Because there is no such thing as the typical Italian, or the typical English, or the typical Brazilian. Essentially, in this slide, it is a question of some people prefer talking, Some people prefer being silent or being restrained. Often cited in the literature is, for instance, people from the Far East tend, for instance, not to challenge lecturers because that is seen as being impolite or being deferent to authority. Whereas in the Western cultures, perhaps this is seen as more or less normal, at least in certain settings. So there are these sort of distinctions, but one has to take them with a pinch of salt. In fact, the writer Lawrence Splitter makes a distinction between the personal identity and the literal identity. And he says the literal identity is unlikely to change. I was born Damien, I will probably remain Damien, and I will probably die Damien. I was born a male, I will probably remain a male, and I will probably die a male. So in certain aspects of the literal identity. But then there is a different type of identity, an identity which is always changing, an identity which is based more on my viewpoints. And having said this, people change. And therefore, one can question. For instance, I was speaking to somebody today, and he had been brought up, I believe it was in Norway, and then he had come and spent 4 years, I think, or something like that in Scotland, and then he had gone back to his country of origin. There would have been change. Is he the typical Norwegian? Can we classify the typical Norwegian? Even had he been in Norway and remained in Norway, would he have remained the same? And the answer, I can almost say definitely, would be no. Because people develop, people grow, people change, people flux. Definitions of culture, they abound. And not only do they abound, they tend to change over time as well. So I was reading, for instance, the anthropologist Goetz, Clifford Goetz, and his definition of culture, which he produced in the 1970s, and his emphasis on this sort of sense of belonging, on this sense of common belonging, which is certainly valid and which will remain valid. However, there are so many different ways in which culture have been defined, particularly now in our virtual world, in our computer world, where people have ready access to one another and where people might work, behave one way in virtual space and another way in physical space. One has to also understand that the virtual world has also opened up ways in which people can access different cultures simultaneously. I remember once when I was in a library and I was speaking to two students from Eritrea. One was from Ethiopia and the other from Eritrea. And they were in front of their screens and one was reading in Tigrinya and the other person was reading in Amharic. And then somebody came up to them, somebody Maltese, and they answered him and they spoke to him in English. And so you had all these different sort of cultures, all these different languages, all these ways of expressing, literally within the same 2 centimeters, which perhaps may not have been that much accessible to people writing in past times, in past decades, like Goetz. But anyway, at the root of culture, again, we find things like religion, like ethnicity, like the locality which people are from. Some people wrongly assume that people from a certain country have a certain culture. Within a country, you can have a number of cultures, and sometimes the cultures can also be at loggerheads with one another. Gender itself might form an aspect of culture, in the sense that one's beliefs about gender are often formed about culture, around culture. Race, class, they're all common constituents. They are all there within people's relationships. And when it comes to co-creating a culture, therefore, if one were, for instance, to refer to the sociological works of Willis from the 1970s, who wrote about working class lads in a working class culture, and he said that no matter what happens, the culture will permeate and will keep on permeating these lads being in a working class position. And we are to contrast that today with today's virtual reality, which is so open. And yet class is still somehow not that easy to transcend for many people. So within this whole spectre, if one speaks about a university and one speaks about a co-culture and the co-creation of cultures, and one thinks in terms of the branding that one is giving, the message that one is giving, how much is one making it possible for the other to be himself? How much is one making it possible to validate the other person so that that person can possibly transcend these obstacles? Very, very, very often, my experience as a social worker has showed me that people from a certain class background tend to internalize certain messages which they would have got from their home environment. Therefore, certain things they might see as beyond them because they are out of their home culture, they are going out of their personal space, they're going out of their comfort zone in a way perhaps which is different for people from a middle class background. So again, when one thinks about all the literature on multicultural education, these points are very, very often sadly ignored because very, very, very often what we are focusing on is the macro level, but what we tend to forget is the micro level. The relationship, and I'm going to go one step further than that, and within that relationship, our ability to love. We spoke about our dispositions, we spoke about validating, we spoke about supporting, but how much are we there? How much can we really be there for the other? Because ultimately, we cannot co-create a culture which is conducive without love. Social equity. A person who pulls a flower out of the grass. What does that flower mean to me? Do we recognize the beauty of that flower? Do we recognize that that flower forms part of the whole scheme of things? Or do we discriminate? We've spoken about ethnocentricity and ethnocentricity, where we put ourselves at the center of our words in a negative way. We've spoken about power. We've spoken about discrimination when the other is not validated. Stereotyping, cultural blindness. Cultural blindness is sometimes also referred to as being non-responsive. Non-responsive in the sense that we do not empathize. We do not have feelings. We do not show our feelings. We dumb our own feelings. Our cultural imposition, and the literature on cultural imposition is rampant. Starting with the discovery of America or by Christopher Columbus, where Christopher Columbus is described as the great hero who discovered America, but little is said about the massacres and atrocities that were carried out on the native peoples by his discovery. And the list is endless. One can go on. People in power who have rewritten history in one way or another to favor one view and not another. And blocks to cultural communication, I've included this at the end, tonal change. Sometimes it may not be this macro level things at all. Sometimes it can also be our approach, our tone of voice. We can speak to people and not speak to people at the same time. The same can also apply, however, to the literature. I don't know whether any of you have been through the experience of reading through the newspaper and sort of leaving out the sports pages at the end. That's what I do. There are certain ways in which we can engage people. And within a university context, when we are co-creating a common culture, who are we leaving out? Who are we not reaching out to? And if we are using these sort of tonal changes, or if we are excluding people, ultimately, we need to question, are we affecting blocks to cultural communication? Communication itself is complex, and there are numerous books on communication. But most of it is unseen rather than seen, hence the iceberg model, and hence many of the things we have spoken about previously, beliefs, attitudes, values. Dimensions of collaboration. There is the university, there is the educator, there is the curriculum. What is put in the curriculum? What is left out of the curriculum? Assessment. What is emphasized in the assessment? What do lecturers see as important? What do students see as important? Is what students see as important taken into consideration? Does the assessment in some way help to generate a system of understanding and of cohesion? The method of instruction. Is everybody included in the instruction? Who is left out? How are they left out? The dimensions, we talk about students, but behind the students there is the family, behind the family there is the community. How much are these different dimensions considered in university teaching? Of course, this slide would deserve and merit a lecture on its own, but I needed to include it, and I felt it justified to include it, because without there being collaboration, without there being consideration, there cannot be validation, there cannot be empathy, and there will be barriers which are co-created rather than collaboration. The personal experiences of staff and students are so important. How much are they used as a teaching resource? How much are they referred to? How much are they employed? And why is this important? It is important because of self-awareness, because assumptions about self and others is going to influence people's behavior. And people's behavior will influence and impinge on the results of their interaction. With the social comes the cultural, with the cultural comes the behavioral, and underlying all of this, there is the intentional. If one thinks of trust, transparency, and empathy that we have spoken about, versus avoidance, fear, and hate, one can think in a university setting about the confusion and the irritation and the social embarrassment that which would prevail if avoidance were to take over. The need for listening, the need for asking questions, the need for taking action translates into choice, as opposed to becoming defensive. If we are to become defensive, the net result is alienation, people left out. If we are to listen, and again, I bring to mind my grandfather and his active listening and putting me on his shoulders, then we will generate support and understanding. We'll be going into other people's spaces by becoming more aware of our own blind spots. And as the final slide, I have the whole world in my hand. And the reason why I have the whole world in my hand is because I am aware, because I have the propensity to love, because I have the disposition to reach out to others, because I am going to take the time, the effort, the energy to relate to other people, because I want to be there for them, because I want to validate them, and because I want them as central in my life. And ultimately, and this is my last word, within the spectre of love that I have spoken about, I think the most important thing that we need to carry with us today is the reality that we are one family, we are one world, and within a university and a college setting, we are all people who are sharing an important part of our lives together. And with that message, I thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Damien. I'm checking online. You have got a new book, Multiculturalism, Higher Education, Intercultural Communication, coming up. Really looking forward to reading it. So apparently there's a lot of literature talking about the differences between cross-culture and intercultural communication. My question is why the wording, you know, you're choosing intercultural communication as the title of your book and cross-culture apparently used for this particular presentation. And just curious.
Yes. Well, in my book, I explain that I am using intercultural and cross-cultural and multicultural quite interchangeably, in the sense that in the literature, very, very, very often, they are used in such a way as to give the same message, that ultimately people need to relate to one another, and that people need to make an effort to relate to one another, and that people need to understand one another, and they need to make an effort to understand one another. And it is within this corpus of creating this this thrust towards understanding that I am using these words quite interchangeably and quite fluidly.
If there's no more questions, I think we came to the end of the session, and it was a pleasure to have you all here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to thank Denise Boyle, the co-organizer, Edgar Rodriguez, the co-organizer, Vanita Subramyam, the host, and obviously, and very, very importantly, the Equality and Diversity Unit of the University of Edinburgh. I would also like to thank my very good friend, Eric Formosa, for his help with the slides that have been used in this presentation.